On behalf of all organizers, a very warm welcome to the fifth session in the Win Watson webinar series 2020. I'm Paresh Vora. I'm Director, India Operations, Win Foundations. Our diverse geography, people and culture has a range of water and sanitation challenges, and this requires thousands of innovations to be trialed, refined and adopted, whether in technology or products, processes and protocols, delivery and business models. Further ground level empowerment, managerial and technical skilling is required to enable communities and other stakeholders to adopt these innovations, often mix them with traditional methods to meet the needs of a modern society. These webinars aim to showcase leading on-ground innovative projects and also spur discussions and collaborations amongst diverse stakeholders to reach such innovations to the communities. The series is jointly organized by some of the leading institutions and social organizers in this domain, namely IIT Kharagpur, ARIT Communities and Technologies, SEPT University Ahmedabad, IIT Bombay, IIT Gandhinagar, which is in charge of this session, and Win Foundation. We welcome the diverse attendees, experienced researchers, faculty, NGO members, industry experts, government officers, and independent professionals and enthusiastic students from India and also from some other countries across the world. We have seen very active question and answer session in the past session, and we expect the same. At this moment, I would like to invite Mr. Ron Mehta, Executive Director, Win Foundation, to say a few words. Over to you, Ron.
Thank you very much, Paresh. It is a pleasure to join this webinar today. Just a brief introduction of what WIN stands for. WIN stands for Wheels India Niswarth Foundation, which was established about 2.5 to 3 years ago as a United States-based nonprofit by alumni of various IITs in the US who approached a very generous philanthropist, Indian American, Mr. Chirag Patel and his wife Preeti Patel, and with a very generous donation of over $2 million over the past 2 years, we have addressed specifically our vision of to support innovations in water and sanitation, in short for WATSAN, and in maternal and child health issues to improve the daily lives of the poor and at the lowest economic strata of Indian society in a manner such that initiatives supported by our foundation are sustainable and scalable in the future. So with that in mind, over the past 2 years, we have supported various water-based initiatives in elite institutions like IIT Bombay, IIT Kharagpur, IIT Gandhinagar, where our WIN Foundation is headquartered, and also with some very creative and innovative NGOs like ARIT Communities and Technologies in Kutch, which is supported along with by Tata Power CSR. Without any further ado, I turn it back to Paresh to continue the webinar. Thank you very much.
I'll take this opportunity to introduce our main speaker today, Professor Jai Chandar Swaminathan. He is the Kanchan and Harilal Doshi Chair, Assistant Professor for Water at the Kiran Patel Center for Sustainable Development, IIT Gandhinagar. Professor Jai Chandar did his PhD from MIT, Boston, USA, majoring in energy sciences, and then spent 1 year as a postdoctoral associate at MIT with the Tata Center for Design for Technology and Design. His areas of research interest include thermodynamics, heat, and mass transfer. He has co-authored over 20 journal articles in the areas of energy efficient design and operation of desalinization processes, renewable energy technologies, membrane fouling and degradation, and decision making under uncertainty. He has received several awards, including the MIT Carl G. Sontheimer Prize for Creativity and Innovation in Design and the US BOR Innocentiv Challenge Prize. He has a BTech from IIT Madras and Masters from MIT. Pleased to introduce Dr. Jaichandra Swaminathan. Over to him.
Thank you so much, Paresh ji, and welcome everybody to this webinar. I hope I'm audible. So the topic for today's session is addressing bottlenecks in energy and materials in water treatment and desalination. I personally will be focusing on desalination and energy. My colleagues, Professor Manish and Chinmay, will address some of the issues with respect to materials and other water treatment technologies. So a very quick introduction about where we come from. So today's session is organized by the Dr. Kiran C. Patel Center for Sustainable Development, housed at IIT Gandhinagar. IIT Gandhinagar is located on the banks of the river Sabarmati, around 20 to 30 minutes from Ahmedabad city. We like to think of our campus as a laboratory, a living lab for sustainable technologies and innovations. So on the right, you see some snapshots of such initiatives. So on the top, there is the evaporative cooling system in the student mess. We have solar panels, not just on our rooftops of the academic buildings, but also to provide shade in the car parking. And on the bottom is something related to our today's session. We see the root zone water treatment system for treating the wastewater produced on campus. This treated wastewater is also reused within campus for horticulture and field irrigation purposes. So with that introduction, let's get into the topic of the first session. So I said I'll be focusing on desalination. So as the name suggests, desalination refers to the removal of salts from water. And the application that comes to our mind immediately is that of potable water production or drinking water production from the sea. However, the same technologies that can do this are today used in a range of applications, and I tried to categorize these in terms of the combination of the source water that they work with and the product or application that they serve. So the source water can actually be seawater, but you know, it can also be brackish groundwater where the salinity is not that high. It can be natural surface waters, domestic wastewater, industrial waste streams. And in terms of the application, the produced pure water can be used for drinking, but it can also be sometimes used for agriculture or for industrial applications. Another interesting application of desalination technologies is where the goal is not really to produce pure water, but actually to produce a concentrated brine stream or a highly saline stream. And this happens to be the situation when an industry is mandated to enforce zero liquid discharge or for minerals and other valuable product extraction from wastewater streams. So how does desalination fit into the overall gamut of water treatment technologies? So here we show various potential contaminants in water, and they are on the X direction. You see different sizes. So on the extreme right are contaminants that are visible to the naked eye, for example, sand and so on. As you go to the left, you see more and more smaller contaminants. You see bacteria, viruses, endotoxins, sugar, and all the way up to aqueous salt, metal ions, and finally water molecules or atomic radii, right? And corresponding to these, there are also technologies that are available to remove each of these. So at the larger scale, you can perform particulate filtration with membranes with relatively smaller pore sizes. We can go for microfiltration, ultrafiltration, and so on. And desalination technologies are essentially to the extreme left at the bottom, where we think about processes for separation. And they are able to remove the dissolved impurities from water. So when we say that they can remove dissolved impurities from water, it is also obvious that they will remove everything else to the right also, right? Here I've listed a couple of technologies that usually are referred to as desalination technologies. We have reverse osmosis and then distillation processes. But one thing to note here is as we go from the right to the left, the size of these contaminants and impurities reduces, and correspondingly, the specific energy requirement to separate out these contaminants increases, right? So because of this, the desalination processes are much more energy intensive per unit of product produced compared to, for example, particulate filtration. Because of this reason, we can also think of desalination technologies as sometimes being overkill. Let's say the water stream that you are treating does not really have dissolved impurities, it only has bacteria, you will probably not require desalination technologies. However, more and more we see that desalination technologies are heavily used, either to be extra cautious when the water is being used for drinking purposes, especially when there are micropollutants that are at very small quantities in the water that cannot really be detected easily. So desalination technologies can be categorized in different ways. I like to categorize them in terms of the type of energy that is supplied to these technologies. So on the left, we have electricity powered technologies. We've already looked at RO or reverse osmosis, but also we can have mechanical vapor compression, which is actually a evaporation and condensation based process, but the energy supply is provided in the form of a compressor, so in the form of electricity. There are also electrochemical processes such as electrodialysis and capacitive deionization. In the heat driven processes, we have various kinds of distillation as well as thermal vapor compression. And you can also think of chemical energy powered processes such as ion exchange resins, which are able to adsorb ions such as sodium and chloride, and in their place release hydrogen and hydroxide ions so that the outgoing stream is pure. So what is the status of these technologies in India? So in India, as of 2018, the total installed capacity of desalination plants comes out to around 2,500 million liters per day. And here is a state-wise breakup of where these technologies are implemented. Interestingly, around half of the desalination has been implemented in Gujarat, which is where we are located. In next place is Tamil Nadu, which around quarter of all the installed capacity, and all the other states contribute only the remaining quarter. In Tamil Nadu, it's primarily the seawater desalination for drinking water production that is been implemented in large part. Whereas in Gujarat, on the other hand, up to 2018, most of this installed capacity is actually not for drinking water production, but for industrial applications like power plants, as well as other industries like pharmaceutical industries and so on, both for pure water production as well as for effluent management. In terms of the technology distribution, again, we see a very clear trend. Reverse osmosis dominates. Around 85% of all the installed capacity is with reverse osmosis. And in next place is multi-effect distillation, which is a thermal distillation process. And all the other technologies like vapor compression, electrodialysis, forward osmosis, and so on contribute only to the remaining 1%. So part of this talk today will be to try to understand why this is the way it is, and also to understand what are some of the energy and cost numbers that go with these numbers, so that we get a better understanding of what kind of treatment or desalination process we would have to implement in a particular application. So particularly, I like to think about the bottlenecks associated with desalination in terms of energy and materials. So the material bottleneck comes out in the form of the capital costs that needs to be invested in the technology. So the overall cost of treatment can be broken down into the capital cost and the operating cost. Within capital cost, of course, there are multiple subheadings, of which we will focus on the material of the desalination system itself. For example, the membrane for the reverse osmosis process, or the metal heat exchangers for the distillation process, and so on. In the operating cost, again, we have things like manpower, maintenance, and replacement. But the major chunk of the cost comes from energy, which is a repeated operating cost. Right. So the overall specific cost of water can actually be expressed as the specific cost of system size divided by flux, which is the production per unit area per unit time of water, plus the specific cost of energy, for example, the cost of energy per unit kilowatt hour, divided by the energy efficiency. So if a process has a higher flux, then the capital cost contribution to the specific cost reduces. And if the process has a higher energy efficiency, correspondingly, the operating cost contribution to the total cost reduces. So we want to have both high flux, high J, and high energy efficiency. Let's look at what are the fundamental limits on energy consumption. So we said that as the impurity size reduces, the corresponding energy requirement increases. Is there any fundamental limit below which we cannot go? Thankfully, there is such a limit that can be found out using thermodynamics. So here I'm considering a black box separator that is taking in a feed solution at some salinity SF and converting or separating it into a product and a concentrate at a higher salinity. This black box separator, which means that I'm agnostic about the actual technology which is inside this device as of now, takes energy in the form of work and may release some energy to the ambient in the form of heat. So if I'm interested in finding out the specific electrical energy input or the electrical energy per unit volume, it is only a function of the salinity of the feed, salinity of the product, and the salinity of the brine. This information can be plotted as shown here. I can plot the least work or the least electricity consumption versus the recovery ratio, which is a fraction of the incoming feed water that is converted into product for different salinities of feed. So SF equal to 35 grams per kilogram corresponds to seawater salinity. And again, there are different curves I can plot for different product salinity. So 500 ppm is usually the TDS limit for drinking water. And the other numbers are much smaller numbers that you usually get with RO systems, right? So as we reduce the salinity of the feed, correspondingly, you see that the thermodynamic limit minimum energy requirement decreases. A number that is quite useful to us to understand current situation is to look at what is the energy consumption for seawater reverse osmosis or seawater desalination, not reverse osmosis, operating at around 50% recovery. So if you look at this, then that corresponds to a number of 1 kWh per meter cube or 1 unit of electricity per kiloliter of product. Okay. So what does this translate to in terms of cost? So if you consider that the cost of electricity is around 5 to 10 rupees per unit, then correspondingly, the minimum energy cost that we cannot go below is around half a paisa to 1 paisa per liter. So it's quite small compared to what you would imagine, like what you would pay for like a bottle of purified drinking water, for example, right? But note that desalinated water is going to be supplied for all kinds of application, not just for drinking. And so this number has to be compared with something else. So let's look at how or what this number needs to be essentially compared with. So usually when we think about desalination or seawater desalination, it is often mentioned that it is energy intensive. In this context, it is good to think about what are the real options that we have so that we can make a fair comparison. So when we need to supply water, we either need to take water from a place that it's available at and transport it to a place where it is required. So the left hand side of this table talks about conveyance or transportation of water. There is no treatment involved here. And so here, even if you have groundwater, if it's at a depth of around 120 meter, it requires around 0.6 units of electricity per kiloliter to be pumped up, right? Similarly, if you have water that is not immediately accessible, let's look at this particular example. If you want to take Kaveri River water to Bangalore, this is coming from a distance of 100 kilometers and it also needs to be raised by a height of 300 meters. And so based on these numbers, we can estimate that it takes around 1.6 units of electricity per kiloliter to transport this water, right? In contrast, let's look at the actual energy consumption numbers for desalination. So for reverse osmosis, brackish water reverse osmosis, the numbers are around 0.4 to 2. And for seawater, it's around 3 to 5. So the minimum number for seawater we said was 1. The actual number is around 3 to 4, right? So based on these numbers, the comparison of these is what you will decide whether to go ahead with getting water from somewhere else where it's available or producing it locally using some kind of treatment process. Another interesting number that I would like to point your attention to here is recycling to potable use. So let's say you are in Bangalore city and you have already used water and it's in the form of sewage. Something that is gaining traction in a lot of places around the world is that of treating the sewage to such a good quality that it can actually be, it's up to the potable quality level. Of course, it might be supplied for other uses and correspondingly the energy consumption there is around 0.5 to 1.5. So here you can immediately see that it's lower than transporting water and it might be quite competitive to use desalination technologies for this application. Okay. So now let's look at the energy consumption itself and what goes into it. So if you look at reverse osmosis and what goes into the specific energy consumption of reverse osmosis, the way the process works is quite simple. We have a membrane that allows pure water to pass, but not salts. But in order to make pure water pass through the membrane, you need to pressurize the water. So how much pressure do you need to apply? So well, that's a function of the salinity of the water. So there's something called the osmotic pressure, which scales with the solution salinity. If the osmotic pressure at the outlet of the membrane is pi out, we need to supply at least a pressure greater than pi out in order to sustain a positive flux throughout the membrane. So this tells us the minimum pressure that we have to supply has to be greater than the osmotic pressure at the outlet. Now, if I want to understand the energy input associated with supplying this pressure, let me consider producing one unit of pure water at recovery ratio of RR. Correspondingly, I have 1 by RR is the amount of feed water that is taken in. And so I can just multiply this 1 by RR with the pressure. And so the specific energy consumption becomes pi out into 1 by RR, or pi out divided by RR. Okay. So this is the minimum energy that you have to supply. Can we do better? We can, because you have a brine stream that is leaving that is also at high pressure. So we can extract the energy from this high pressure stream using a turbine. And if you do this, then part of the energy that is being supplied to the pump can actually be recovered from the turbine by extracting it from the high pressure brine stream. And after doing this, if you just do the math, we see that the specific energy consumption reduces to pi out. So instead of being pi out by RR, it is just pi out. Remember that RR is a number between 0 and 1. So this number is going to be higher than this number. If we consider this percentage savings in energy that is obtained by using a turbine, we show that this is 1 minus recovery ratio. So if you're operating a desalination process at a recovery ratio of 50%, like what seawater systems are usually operated at, then the percentage energy savings that we can obtain by using a turbine is around 50%. Right. So this has really contributed to the reduction in energy and the reduction in the cost of water from desalination. So here on this chart, we are showing the cost per unit meter cube of water in dollar per meter cube with respect to time. So initially, thermal processes were only available for desalination, and over time, reverse osmosis became more available and also well developed. And you can see a very steep decline in the cost of reverse osmosis produced water. And it has kind of stabilized over the last 10 to 15 years. Right? So if you look at the green portion of these bars, that is talking about the electrical power. You can see that there is a clear reduction in the electrical power cost from 1980s to around 2000s. Right? And this is for the most part contributed by the turbine-based energy recovery that I showed on the previous slide. Before looking at the turbines, I just want to point out that the cost of desalinated water as of today is around $0.7 per meter cube, or in rupees, around 5 paise per liter, or 50 rupees per kiloliter of produced water. Okay, so this is the actual cost to the utility in Chennai, for example, where they are producing seawater, drinking water from the sea. In contrast, the households pay around anywhere between 5 to 30 to 40 rupees per kiloliter, depending on their usage, whereas industries often pay more than 50 rupees. So it makes sense for the utility in Chennai to produce seawater, desalinated water, and supply it to industries, which is exactly what they're doing. In terms of energy recovery, the turbine has gone through several iterations and innovations. So instead of having a shaft connecting a separate turbine and the pump, we've gone to designs where the turbine and pump are integrated into one device. And more recently, we even have what are called isobaric pressure exchangers, where the pressure transfer happens directly from one fluid to the other. So that's about reverse osmosis energy consumption. The other technology that we saw was multi-effect distillation. Here, the process works as follows. We supply steam or heat to one effect, which ends up evaporating water. Basically, distillation involves boiling or evaporation of water, which then has to condense. The way this process is made more energy efficient is by not just condensing the vapor to produce liquid, but also using that condensation to produce more vapor in the subsequent effects, right? So here, this one time we supply steam, and that energy, that heat, is used n times to evaporate more and more water. And so the specific heat requirement is reduced as just HFG, or the enthalpy of evaporation, divided by n, because we are reusing this heat n times. Okay, so this HFG number is 666 kilowatt hours per meter cube. So quite high compared to the numbers that we've seen. But so what does this mean? In terms of overall energy consumption, RO, we said, consumes around 3 kilowatt hours of electricity per meter cube. Multi-effect distillation consumes 666 divided by 10, around 70 kilowatt hours of thermal energy per meter cube. plus around 2 kilowatt hours of electrical energy per meter cube. But not all energy has the same value. So in thermodynamics, some of you would have studied that there is this concept of exergy, which helps you compare different units of energy. Even though the unit is kilowatt hour, the thermodynamic value of the energy is different, which is essentially what this concept tells us. So basically, 1 kilowatt hour of electricity is much more valuable thermodynamically speaking compared to 1 kilowatt hour of steam at 140 degrees Celsius compared to 1 kilowatt hour of steam energy or heat energy at 100 degrees Celsius. Okay, so that creates a problem in terms of comparing the energy consumption of these technologies directly. So one interesting piece of work that we've done is to be able to compare different desalination technologies using different kinds of energies on an even footing by considering the fact that the energy from a common source. For example, the heat and energy can be obtained from a cogeneration power plant, but the power plant itself receives its heat energy from a fuel that is burnt in a combustor. So in term, if I just convert the electricity and the low grade thermal energy all the way back to the fuel, then I can convert them into a common unit where they can be directly compared. So here I've done that and showed that RO has an energy of around 6 kilowatt hours of primary energy, whereas multi-effect distillation has an energy of 11 kilowatt hours of primary energy. So clearly RO is the winner, even if you compare on a equal footing. And this is shown in practice also. So here is a graph that is showing the installed capacity of different desalination technologies based on the technology. And you can clearly see that while the membrane-based processes is showing an exponential growth from around 1995, the thermal processes are showing a much more slower growth because you need to be near a power plant to effectively use thermal processes. And the effective cost of water is also higher with these thermal processes. So an interesting fundamental question that we are asking is what makes RO really more energy efficient from a scientific or a fundamental perspective? Because both of them, if you look, think about it, are doing the same process, right? They're both taking salt water, separating it into a freshwater stream and a highly saline stream. What makes RO fundamentally more energy efficient is the fact that the barrier layer in reverse osmosis that is performing the separation is actually extremely thin. So with the current generation of RO membranes that we are using, the barrier layer is usually made of polyamide and it is around 100 nanometers, 100 to 150 nanometers in thickness. So here is a cartoon that shows the different layers in a membrane. Only this top yellow layer is actually doing the separation, right? So if we compare this to what happens in a distillation process, there the if you think about the condensation film, even that is around 200 microns thick. So we are talking about three orders of magnitude difference in thickness of the condensate film. And this is just one of the resistances to heat transfer in a thermal distillation process. So overall, if you think about it, the overall resistance to the process, again, comparing with on common units, comes out to be around 20 times higher. So if you want multi-effect distillation to energetically beat RO, either we have to use 20 times more area or we have to come up with materials and systems that can reduce this resistance by 20 times. So one such option, particularly focusing on condensation, relates to drop-wise condensation rather than film-wise condensation. So here you see the condensate drops are very thin and they get shed off the surface really quickly. And this really enhances the heat transfer coefficient associated with condensation. So such materials could help to bridge this gap between these technologies. But in principle, we need to reduce the resistance of the process if you want to bridge this gap. So let's think about whether there is, how much room really there is in terms of improvement of seawater RO. So we've shown that seawater reverse osmosis is the leader really for in terms of desalination technologies. But how much can we improve seawater RO itself? So we said that the theoretical or thermodynamic minimum energy was 1 unit per meter cube. The actual energy we said was around 3.7. So we say around 3.4 to 4. So it looks like the actual energy is around 3 to 4 times higher than the theoretical limit. So it looks like there is a lot of scope for improvement of seawater RO. But if we investigate further, we realize that the RO portion of this energy is only around 2 kilowatt hours per meter cube. So the remaining is actually the energy that it takes to bring seawater from the deep ocean, dispose the brine outfall back into the deep ocean, pre-treatment of the seawater. So if you look at the RO portion alone, it only contributes around 2 kilowatt hours. So it's only 2 times higher than the theoretical limit. And even here with a single stage RO, the limit is determined by the osmotic pressure of the exit. and that comes out to around 1.4. So the actual energy savings that we can get by improving RO membranes or by improving the pump efficiency or the turbine efficiency is only this portion. So this corresponds to only 15% savings, even with the most advanced membranes that we can think of, right? So that again ties back well with the picture that we saw, that the cost numbers have really settled down more or less for seawater reverse osmosis. What about the other RO systems? So I'm sure not all of you here are specifically interested in seawater reverse osmosis. So here I thought I can take a quick look at kitchen top RO units that are becoming quite popular as a point of use treatment system. So here we can notice that energy is not really a major concern because the salinity is the stream is quite low. Therefore, we do not use any energy recovery turbines and the system is operated at low recovery ratio, right? So correspondingly, I looked up some numbers, the electrical power consumption was 60 watt and the production rate was 15 liters per hour. This corresponds to 4 units of electricity per kiloliter. So you can actually see that this is more than seawater energy consumption, right? And it's also obviously much farther away from the theoretical least work, which in this case is even lower. It's around 0.2 units of electricity per kiloliter. Okay, so why is this the case and why do people not care? Because in reality, it doesn't matter to the end user all that much. For the end user, the power cost is trivial. It comes out to around 3 paisa per liter, and usually people who can afford these systems are already quite well off. And also, even if you think about it from a full year perspective, if I consider that this system operates and produces around 15 liters of water per day, over an entire year, I'm only consuming 22 units of electricity, which is lower than what other appliances might consume on a monthly basis. But I thought that it's important to highlight this because from a policymaker's perspective, this might still be interesting. Because as we have energy standards for other appliances, if you multiply the number of devices over an entire city, the actual energy savings that we can get by making these devices more energy efficient can be significant. Right? So in this next section, I want to quickly go over a general framework to how to go about improving the energy efficiency of particularly desalination systems, but also in general, any of these energy systems. So what I'm trying to do here is I've used each of these methods for different desalination technologies, but I'm trying to bring it down to its essence and not really go into the technical details, but and also highlight the trade-offs associated with each method. So often we hear ideas about how to improve the energy efficiency, but I think it's really important to keep in mind the corresponding trade-offs so that we actually know whether the method makes sense. Okay. So in principle, what we are thinking about is that the dissipation goes as J squared R, where J is the flux and R is the resistance. So then this equation will be familiar to a lot of you in terms of the dissipation in an electric insulator. I squared R tells you the heat generation rate, right? So similarly, J squared R tells you the dissipation in a process, right? So either I can reduce my J or I can reduce my R, or I can equally distribute my flux, or I have to reduce my minimum energy consumption itself. So these are the 4 broad categories in which you can reduce the energy consumption of the actual desalination process itself. So let's look at the trade-offs associated with this. If I want to reduce my operating flux, the simplest way to do it is by increasing system size, right? So here I have a system that is small. I need a large driving force or a large pressure. If I keep increasing my system size, I need a smaller and smaller pressure, and so smaller and smaller energy. So correspondingly, if I plotted the energy efficiency versus flux, you see that there is a trade-off. So if I want to operate at high energy efficiency, I necessarily need to operate at low flux. But this is a problem, right? So because I said that the overall cost has this form, so once the flux reduces, the capital cost contribution to the total cost of water shoots up. So below a certain flux, the overall specific cost of water again starts increasing, right? So therefore, there is always an optimum value at which these systems are designed. So here for seawater RO conditions, you can see that this optimal is around 15 to 20 liters per meter squared per hour, which is where these systems are actually also operated. Okay, that's the first trade-off that I wanted to highlight. The second trade-off does not account for capital cost. So let's say that capital cost is not a problem. The system cost is really cheap. Even then, it turns out that I cannot continuously reduce my operating flux because of parasitic losses. So here, if you look at this graph, the water flux is reducing as I reduce my applied pressure, but the salt flux is independent of applied pressure. Salt flux is only a function of the salinity difference between the two sides. So because the salt flux remains constant and the water flux reduces, I'm pushing the same amount of salt through this membrane, but much less amount of water. So the product that I'm producing becomes more and more salty, right? So it's not really going to be high quality product. So correspondingly, the salt rejection reduces and it's no longer a useful desalination process. So this I call parasitic losses. Analogy or system that can make it clear, I thought, was the fuel economy of a vehicle. So we can understand that the fuel economy of a vehicle drops off if you try to go really fast, because when you start going really fast, then you have to fight against the wind resistance. But then what you notice here is that if you start going really slow also, the fuel economy starts to drop off again. And if you go at 0 miles per hour or 0 kilometer per hour, the fuel economy goes to zero. This is because the engine has to run and you're not doing anything. You're just staying there. So even though the air drag is essentially eliminated, the other losses from the engine, like heat loss from the engine, remains. And so your overall efficiency drops, right? So this is another thing to keep in mind when we think about improving energy efficiency. Another really interesting thing to think about is the membrane, right? So I told you about how the membrane has been improved so much that the systems are performing really well now. But we see in both the science journals, so talking about really significant improvements in energy through membrane improvements. So we see here a title in the AICHE magazine on new graphene desalination that can require 100 times less energy. And then there is an ArcSci paper that's talking about requiring 3.6 into 10 to the power minus 3 kilowatt hour per meter cube. So these are all much lower than the theoretical thermodynamic limit that I mentioned. So immediately you can see that these numbers cannot really be the case. And so this is exactly what's shown in this graph here. So on the x-axis, you show the membrane permeability. So as we keep increasing membrane permeability, there are diminishing returns. So beyond a point, your energy does not decrease further, because after a point, the membrane is not the major resistance. Something else might become the major resistance. And also beyond a point, you just get very close to the theoretical limit. There is not much more improvement that you can get, right? So is making new membranes completely useless then? Well, not really, because this slide shows us that we cannot get improvements in terms of energy, but we can get improvement in terms of capital cost. Because what matters at the end of the day for the system performance is the product of the membrane permeability and the membrane area. So if you make your membrane permeability higher, you can use a lower membrane area to get the same performance, right? So if you make a membrane that is 10 times more permeable, I can use just 1/10 of the area. So overall, it's possible that capital cost can be reduced by focusing on membrane improvements, just not energy. The next method is to equally distribute the flux in terms of the science of this. This is the most interesting, but it also takes a lot more time to explain, and I'm already not doing very well on time. So I'm going to skip this third method, and if there are any questions, I can take that at that point. And quickly talk about a few other more practical cases. So if the fourth method is to re-engineer your system to reduce the least energy requirement itself. So instead of focusing on the dissipation or the entropy generation, if you focus on reducing the thermodynamic limit itself, then again you can improve your process, right? So this I think is particularly interesting in the case of industrial water treatment, because you have some flexibility in terms of what chemicals that you use in your industrial process. In contrast, seawater is just fixed by nature, groundwater is fixed by nature, but in the industry you have this choice, right? And so in the previous graphs, I had just showed you the energy consumption as a function of recovery ratio for a specific salinity. Here I'm showing that at the same salinity, depending on the actual salt, the energy consumption numbers vary very vastly. So sodium chloride requires much more energy compared to sodium sulfate or magnesium sulfate or zinc sulfate, right? So in this context, the particular work that we are doing here is related to the textile dyeing industry, where they are interested in implementing zero liquid discharge to continue to operate in the new environmental regulations. What this means is that most of the water they have to recirculate within their system, and they have to use a desalination system to do this. So in this context, what we say is that we choose the chemicals that are added in the processing steps carefully so that we can reduce the energy consumption in the desalination step. So here are some results of this analysis. So if you look at the same feed salinity, if you want to do sodium chloride, the energy consumption to concentrate it up to 70 grams per kilogram is around 50% higher than for sodium sulfate, even though we are interested in concentrating up to a much higher salinity, right? There are other practical advantages associated with this desalination of the textile dyeing wastewater with sodium sulfate, because we can use nanofiltration membranes rather than RO membranes, because the pore size requirement is not that small. And here are some actual dyed fabric samples from my partner in Tamil Nadu called SP Textile Processors. So here we used the recycled water with nanofiltration and compared it with fresh water to look at the color difference. And this color difference graphs tells us the difference that is obtained in reality. So quickly, one last application. Where are the opportunities for innovation really with desalination technology? So we saw the industrial context, we saw the context of high salinity streams. Here, I wanted to focus more on off-grid water production with solar energy, using solar energy. So this graph is from Renewable and Sustainable Energy Reviews that shows about the cost of producing water with solar energy as a function of the capacity of the system with various different solar powered technologies. So one thing you can notice is that in this limit of the lower productions, so if you are thinking of less than 100 liters per day for small communities, the only technology that has been effectively shown is the solar still technology, and its cost is much higher. It's like around $10 to $50 per meter cube compared to the numbers that we saw, which are around $0.5, around one order of magnitude higher. So one idea then would be to use the principles that we discussed to improve the energy efficiency of such solar driven off-grid distillation systems, so that we actually reduce the energy requirement and also correspondingly reduce the cost of producing water from these systems. So this solar still is a very simple process. It's completely passive, but the energy efficiency, which quantifies how much pure water we produce related to the heat input from the sun, is only 0.3, whereas the thermodynamic limit is 200. So we see there's a large scope for improvement. Based on a technology that I worked extensively for in my PhD with, called membrane distillation, what we propose to do is to have a very thin film of evaporation and condensation, with the condensation being used to preheat the feed water so that we are not wasting the condensation energy by releasing it to the ambient. The idea here is that we might be able to increase the energy efficiency from 0.3 to 3 and correspondingly reduce the cost. So very quickly, some preliminary or initial results with this project. So here on the left, you see air gap distillation system with the thin film. This is a CAD drawing that is showing how we are implementing this thin film of evaporation and thin film of condensation. What is critical in this project is to have some surface modifications that enable us to really achieve these thin films. So we've tried cloths, different types of clothes. We've tried a super hydrophilic coating on the surface, and we also tried to have a mesh on top of the surface. So the mesh is a very simple solution that is giving us very promising results. So on the bottom right, you see the results. So compared to 5 millimeter air gap, which has been shown by others in the literature, if you go to 3 millimeters of air gap without the mesh, the condensation and evaporation films start touching and the salt just directly gets transferred and you don't get any desalination. But with the mesh, we're able to effectively reduce this gap and therefore get much higher efficiency. So we have shown efficiency of around 1.6 using water temperature of 70 degrees on the hot side and 20 degrees on the cold side. So with that, I would like to conclude by saying that RO outperforms all the other desalination technologies. I only spoke about multi-effect distillation, but it also outperforms the other technologies. And the reason for this is that the RO membranes have been very effectively engineered to have a very thin barrier layer that performs the actual separation. For other applications, though, there is no clear winner as yet, and there are significant savings that can be achieved. We spoke about 4 general principles to improve energy efficiency, but also importantly thought about the trade-offs associated with each of these methods. And we also very briefly looked at some niche applications where other technologies might be useful. So I would like to acknowledge the funding agencies for this work, and also my research group at MIT, collaborating with whom some of the research that I showed here was performed. The Tata Center has funded some of the textile work, and the Department of Science and Technology again has given a grant related to the textile dyeing work. And very importantly, I would also like to thank all my group members in IIT Gandhinagar for their contribution. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Professor Jayachandra, for this excellent talk. I would now next introduce the next speaker, Professor Chinmay Goroy. He is the B.S. Gelott Chair Professor of Chemical Engineering at IIT Gandhinagar. He received PhD in chemical engineering from IIT Bombay. He is coordinator for Center for Safety Engineering and associate dean for campus management at IIT Gandhinagar. His research interests include surface engineering of fine particles and particle reactions for functional materials, among others. Prior to joining IIT Gandhinagar, he worked for 5 years in the industry. He has published about 45 international peer-reviewed journal papers and more than 55 conference papers. He has received several awards, such as the Excellence in Research Award from IIT Gandhinagar, Excellence in Institute Building Award at IIT Gandhinagar, Employee Excellence Award from Invensys Process Systems Hyderabad, when he was working in industry, and R.G. Manudhane PhD Student Excellence Award at IIT Bombay. Welcome, Professor Chinmay Goroy, and I hand over to him for his address.
Thank you, Harish ji. I'll just check. Am I audible? Yes. Thank you, Parishji, for a nice introduction. I would like to thank WIN Foundation for giving this opportunity to present our work in the WIN Watson webinar series 2020. I'm going to talk about low cost and non-electric water filter for point of use water disinfection. The work has been done by my PhD student, Dr. Deepa Dixit. She has recently received her doctoral degree. So I'm just going to present her work. So as we know that the United Nations recognize that safe water, safe and the affordable drinking water is one of the fundamental human rights. However, more than 800 million of people throughout the world are deprived from this safe water, getting safe water in their home. Even whatever water we are taking through the pipelines, so after the municipal corporations, the treatment plant, the pipeline contain about 10 to the power 4 to 10 to the power 5 cells per ml, that bacteria microbe concentration. And we are using a lot of advanced technology to get the safe water in our home. But these technologies are very much costly, and then availability and accessibility of these advanced technology is very difficult for low income groups or low income communities in developing countries. As a research group, we are one of our major research area is the particle engineering. So what we did that, whether we can develop some low cost material for which can be used as a filter material to disinfect water. So we have done that nanotexturing or surface engineering on a particles which is easily available and low cost. Here we have taken the glass particles, very easily available in the market. We tried to make it a low cost product or which is affordable by low income group. We tried to get rid of any energy requirement, means we tried to make it non-electric, that means it is gravity driven filter. Beyond these low income groups, but the Indian Army who were posted in very difficult terrain, so this kind of product will be very much beneficial for our soldiers. Also, we wanted to get rid of the harmful disinfection byproducts, which is a result of many of the traditional approach like chlorination. So while we tried to design this, I think we need to understand a lot of thing in the bacteria and surface interactions, which depends on various parameters of the water, of the bacteria itself, and mostly that substrate properties, that substrate surface energy, substrate surface charge, the topography, etc., which ultimately results or dictate the collision efficiency, collection efficiency, and the deposition rate of these bacteria, which is nothing but which dictate the probability of sticking these bacteria on the surface of this bed material. So we started with the simple glass particles available in the market. We just treated with the alkali, sodium hydroxide, which we everybody knows that if we keep the glass in presence of alkali, etched out this glass. So we use that property, but we did in a very controlled manner so that we land up with a nano surface roughness and having a specific distribution of those roughness. So we onward we'll call that particles as a surface engineered particle which has been treated with the alkali. So this is our surface engineered particle. Now we have used the surface engineered particle to make a bed. So this is a bed, and we have prepared the simulated water solution having bacterial concentration around 3 × 10⁸ cells per ml using E. coli, and then try to pass through this bed made up of ACP. So after that, whatever filtrate we got, so we measured that optical density, and we saw that the original particle, so this original particle I'm naming as OP, so original particle having log reduction about 0.5, with respect to that, our surface engineered bed material is giving 5 times more log reduction, which is equivalent to your 99.448% of E. coli removal. And if you see the plate results, you'll see that this is the original feed solution where a lot of bacteria is there. In the optical, in the original particle, you will see there is a little bit of reduction. I think this reduction is about 45%. That is mainly to the adherence of these bacteria on the surface of these original glass particles. However, once we treated or once we pass this simulated water with bacteria containing 3 × 10⁸ cells per ml, we found that there is no bacteria, and that is the percentage 99.48%. And if you see the turbidity of that water, the initial water was little bit hazy or turbid, but OP is OP, and you cannot distinguish between two almost similar kind of thing. But this one, which is coming from the SCP material bed, so it's comparatively transparent. However, while I'm saying the efficiency of these material is 99.48%, this is a tremendous this is actually an excellent result, because in literature, without using any of these biocides, we could not find any result which goes beyond 0.5 or 1 log reduction. So with that respect, 2.5 log reduction is huge. However, this 0.52% E. coli seems to be passed through the water, which doesn't coming here after 12 hours. However, after 12 hours means 16 or 18 hours, we found that there is a few colony formation because of that growth of those few bacteria which come out through this bed. So what we did that, so to kill that or to complete adsorption and killing of that bacteria, so we use silver nitrate. That is mainly because to imparting some long time storage capability of this particle. However, this silver nitrate, amount of silver nitrate has been used several times, I think more than 90-95%, less than that already available products in the market. I think we have used about 0.05 millimolar of sodium nitrate. So, silver nitrate. So this silver nitrate, so Ag plus is deposited on this, just you mix this part surface engineered particle into the silver nitrate particle, you will get the SCP plus, that silver loaded surface engineering particle we are saying SCP plus. And then if you see the efficiency, you will see that that log reduction is exactly same whatever we got in the SCP. So my silver addition is not giving me extra facility in terms of the percentage of the log reduction. The same is true for the original particle and original particle loaded with the silver. Same kind of observation that they are almost same and these particles are also same. However, this gives, I think this completely damage the membrane of the bacteria. So this is the SCM picture. So this is the original particle and this is a surface engineered particle. You see what we did that using the alkali, we smoothened that particle in such a way that the roughness here in the original particle was huge. So probably you have, we have reduced around 3 times RMS roughness. And this is the picture where the bacteria has been accumulated as a cluster wise adhesion on the SCP particle. A little bit of distortion of this bacterial membrane. However, this is completely complete destruction while we have mounted some of these silver plus ion on this SCP particle, which we are calling SCP plus. So we got around 99.999999% of E. coli removal efficiency. And then we have done that silver leaching test also, and it is coming around 50 ppb or below 50 ppb, which is below the USCPA and WHO norms, so which is around 100 ppb. So this work has been published in last year in Scientific Report. And then while I have shown you the earlier result on the simulated water containing 3 × 10⁸ cells per ml, here we have done the use the real water from canal and then the outlet of the wastewater treatment plant, sewage treatment plant. So we have passed, we have taken only 10 gram of SCP material. Please note this is SCP, not the SCP plus. And we have passed around 2 liters of water. So this was the this is the original water bacteria. We found the bacteria in the original water. There are different types of bacteria are there because colonies are different type of colonies are there. So after passing that, we saw that complete removal of this bacteria, whatever it was there in the canal water. One thing it also proves that not only E. coli, but these SCP particles, surface engineered particles, can also handle the other type of bacteria. At least that proof of concept has been proven here. At the same time, we have observed that this original part water was a little bit turbid, and after passing through this bed, so we saw that water is very clean. In fact, in terms of the NTU unit, there is reduction from 30 to around 5 or 2 NTU unit. And this is the prototype of this water filter, where inside this casing, we have the packed bed of these glass particles. So let us discuss now what is happening. So we tried to find out that bacteria adhesion mechanism. First, we looked into some of this SCM picture. I have shown that original particle had a lot of roughness, but the surface engineered particles are very much smooth. So that was scanning electron microscopy picture I have shown you. Here I am showing you the AFM atomic force microscopy measurement, where you will see that the root mean square roughness, which was earlier 116 nanometer approximately, that reduced to 3 times, I think, 3 time reduction, which is coming around 40 nanometer. So these kind of roughness and its distribution, which I am not showing here, you need to have a specific distribution of these randomly distributed nano roughness. Not only that, you need to also control the profile. So this is the height profile of these particles. This is the original particles, where peak to peak distance is around 10 nanometer, and see the profile, how rough it is. And after the surface modification, we made it very smooth, and so that I think we have reduced to 2.5 times that peak to peak distance, which is this is done deliberately. If you why? So if you see the bacterial some of the dimension in the bacteria, see this pili So bacteria is this is E. coli. So E. coli having length around 1 to 1.5 micron, width is 0.5 micron, and the flagella is around 20 nanometer and pili around 5 to 8 nanometer. If you see these parameters, these features are exactly similar range. We have whatever roughness we have provided. So this actually makes kind of entanglement on this surface. And otherwise, and then the mechanism is this is the SCP, the surface engineered particle. And while we have treated with the alkali, we found that some of these sodium ion. So these glass beads are soda lime glass beads. So it has sodium, calcium also. So some of these during this alkali treatment, some of these sodium ion comes out from the surface, which actually increases the calcium ion concentration on the surface. That means the surface is a little bit more positive. So my surface is positively charged surface, and this bacteria is E. coli is a negatively charged surface. So due to this electrostatic attraction, these bacteria comes towards these particles. And once it is coming, so then the interaction, the two types of interaction, mainly that van der Waal interactions and the hydrophobic interactions at the favorable adhesion site, it attach or helps to attach there. And then, of course, there is some wedge groups. So this oxygen group also sometime helping to destroy this bacteria. So in terms of this hydrophobicity or hydrophobic interaction, you'll be I'll show you one result of contact angle measurement to show you how much hydrophobic these particles are. So normally you will see that there are super hydrophobic surfaces or very hydrophobic surfaces, but they are in the mainly flat surface. What we have done that these particles is made made very high hydrophobic surfaces. So original particle contact angle was around 79 degree, which after this change in the roughness and the surface groups, so it has been converted into contact angle 147 degree, which is very near to super hydrophobic. Super hydrophobic, we need around 150 degree. But I'll say that very highly hydrophobic in nature, so much so that if you do the upside down, so this water droplet will not fall. So that actually shows the kind of the amount of adhesion force between this water and then these particles. So those interactions is very much favorable to adhere these particles. So ultimately, so this is the mechanism, so that we engineered that particle in such a way that it improved the bacteria adhesion by controlling the surface functional groups and the nanosurface roughness of the particle, which ultimately enhances the collection efficiency and deposition rate, which I have mentioned in one of the slide earlier. In fact, we calculated the collection efficiency, which increases, which just double, and then deposition rate of the bacteria on the surface has been increased about five times. So overall, the novelty of the work is very simple, very easily available, low cost material. You do the surface design in such a way that you get lot of, you can arrest lot of bacteria and you can generate the free water. That is mainly because of the engineering we have done on the each of these particles, which is a combination of the changes in the surface chemistry and then randomly distributed nanoscale roughness. So now without silver, we are getting 99.48% bacteria removal in a continuous mode without using any disinfecting agent is a great achievement. And I have shown you some of the result that even without silver, we can go ahead, at least for the cases where your duration of the use is within 12 hours. So feasibility of the, in terms of the feasibility to get this project into a productization, what we can say that very easily available material, very low cost material, simple, easy, and does not require any expensive equipment or infrastructure. And design is also simple. Not much technical skills is required, so that very small scale enterprise can integrate these filters. And in terms of the cost also, means the material we have used for the 2 liter water I have just shown earlier, material cost was around 9 to 10 rupees. So we have added this money for, because this cost of these plastics and other overhead. So it will be in this range. With respect to the available products in the range of 350 to 1000 rupees a filter, which is there in the market. However, we are in the process of scaling it up, and we have recently patent also this patented this idea. We got the provisional Indian patent, but it is on file condition. Also, very recently, I think Deepa's work has been selected as a Gandhian Young Technology Innovation Award for this work. With this, I'll acknowledge the WIN Foundation for providing this project for financial support to scale up field test and its deployment. We would like to acknowledge IIT Gandhinagar for providing all the research facility. And of course, I deeply appreciate Dr. Deepa's work and her effort in last 5 years to come out with this work. With this, I'll stop here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Goroy. Next, I'll introduce Professor Manish Kumar. The next speaker is faculty member again at IIT Gandhinagar. He obtained his PhD in Environmental Engineering from the University of Tokyo. Is a member of Global Collaboration on Wastewater-Based Epidemiology of COVID-19 and an executive committee member of the International Water Association India chapter. He has received Best Research Award from Young Water Professional, UKRI Grant, Curita Research Award, DST Young Scientist Grant, JSPS Research Fellowship, and many other awards. He is Fellow of Royal Society of Chemistry and has published over 100 articles in international journals. He is editor on the board and on the editorial board member or guest editor on several prestigious journals. Over to you, Professor Manish Kumar.
Sir, you are mute.
So my screen is this is okay. So then I have kept this title for today's talk is about WIN. Of course, Ron has explained it. And a little bit I would talk about that, okay, the implementation or understanding of that. And then WIN-WIN material, because the topic of today's is WIN-WIN material. And these all will be actually the this theme of this webinar is to tackle the water security issues. And thank you very much. I am the affiliate of KPCSD and which is organizing with IIT Gandhinagar and WIN. So I would take little bit. So first, let me explain why WIN, because WIN has given us the funding for these two ideas, which was little bit I would say more advanced than the time, or the maybe it would have taken me time to find the funding. So it was the project title reads micro component quantification of end uses of water consumption in low income setting, although but the idea had the core idea was to was based on the colors of water. The I want to share these colors of water with my audience here is that we all know this clean water, and this clean water is any water like with our supply water, city water, rain water, whatever. It's a kind of our assumption, and my previous speakers have told you that how to achieve that. But the clean water era, while being used get converted into the gray water and black water. And basically, the gray water is everything, all the water, the output after the use, except the toilet use. So black water is when basically when it is, it gets contaminated or when it passes through the human sewage or fecal matter. So the, unless until it is not attached with the fecal matter, it is a gray matter, and that can be reused and reclaimed. And this is, of course, there are other colors like the blue water, and blue water is irrigation water use. This is all the surface water and groundwater basically. We have the green water. Green water, we call it, is a soil porous water. But why it is important to know the types of water is because now the kind of the population growth or urbanization is happening. Perhaps we need to have higher resolution of the waters. And that's why we have to understand that whether this water is worth throwing it up. So if I would talk about the origin is like, the, of course, you can see that how this water can come to the gray water. And so even gray water is now a the reusable source. So we wanted to understand that how much gray water in Ahmedabad or Gandhinagar in such kind of very Indian setting setup is being produced. So, which means that bathing, dishwashing, floor cleaning, laundry, and total this drinking purpose and all the, I mean, the upper ones are these are the end use, and the most of them are will produce gray water rather than the black water. And how to measure that? We can measure direct measurement using the instrument or the machine to put in the each tap, because people doesn't measure that how much they are using. So the, our main focus was to find that what is that amount. And so we have done that one, and it has a lot of implications that I would not take much time. So the basically for water policy and assessment. And so we bought this, the Digimeter, and we also prepared a questionnaire to cross check the results. And so the direct measurement and indirect measurement where happened, we did the questionnaire survey more than 1,000 people. We did short term and long term the meter installation. Meter installation doesn't hamper the water use, so people allow it, and with of course to make them convinced about the uses of that. And then we try to understand the results. Of course, these are the some of the pictures that was the of the actual installment of the meters. And these are the pictures where the lot of people were included in taking the questionnaire survey. So let's talk about the findings. Findings about this is that when we published it in Journal of Environmental Management, and this will be accessible to you all. So worldwide, when we put this thing together, we found that the R square between the total indoor water consumption and amount of gray water is 0.85, which is a which makes sense that the gray water must be not being mixed with a water with fecal, because you know India have a combined sewer system. So combined sewer system, it means the all the 85, if I use 10 liter and 8 liters is gray water, but I mix it with the 2 liters of the black water and all becomes black water. That doesn't make sense, and without a study we cannot compel to the policymaker that please go for it. And apart from that, even I told you that gray matter may be kitchen use or the shower or utensil and or so and so forth. The shower itself shows 0.64 correlation, and shower water hardly have just soap. Of course, it may have some fallen hair and like that, but it is very easily removable, because even in the washroom we have that thing to separate. So once that shower water, which has just a disinfectant or the soap, must be used as a something, and maybe flush water or the like that. So we had then another reason for doing this study was this water use in developing nation. It is time that we can incorporate the findings of these studies, while the developed country has almost have I would say that they have stabilized their end use. And so now the our finding is under review in Science of the Total Environment, where we have reported that the again in Ahmedabad has lesser average water consumption than Gandhinagar. Family size education had the significant the impact, and there is a high correlation between grey water and bathing. And this was even higher than the. Do you remember? I last slide I showed 0.64, and for here it is 0.71. So these and there are many behavioral and technological implications of it. Now the point was that how to have a meaningful use of it. Of course, we put one idea of using the like there is a two the output. I mean the water inlet can be one type, but water outlet can be of two types: black water, which can directly go to the sewage treatment plant, and the grey water, which can be used for the flushing of the top floor. Can grey water can go to the next floor, and then so and so forth, and then finally it can go to the. Of course, we can treat it and we can use it for some meaningful purposes. If not, then somebody said that okay, the all people on the top floor went to the holiday. Then what? So then in that case, we said that okay, we can stack it. That three and three and like that, and then we can have so that the supply problem should not be there. But one more idea was that how about to have a three kind of system, and these are the schemes that can help us to find. The second success story of the WIN, the funded project was WIN-WIN material. And for removing the in situ arsenic and fluoride contamination, and arsenic fluoride contamination are the contamination which delimit or which compromise the ability of poors to meet their drinking water needs. And it is like a spread like a menace. This one, so whenever we start the work, I try to have a complete view of it. And you can see that India have several millions of people who has suffering from under either arsenic or fluoride. And then this is the, we published in Chemosphere, and there we you can see that there are several areas, including where there are both kind of contamination is there. And so challenge was that there are some methods like precipitation membrane and like that, but what method can be used? And we try to develop something, and so that it can be directly implemented to every borewell, and so that it can give rise to the decentralized system. I want to finish in 10 minutes, so I would go ahead with that. That of course we could do that, and then we came up with a WIN-WIN composite material. And there, it was important that membrane also came to the rescue. So you can see that we used some membrane for doing that. And we have done all the tests, and that whether it is low cost or not, non-toxic or comparable adsorption or not. And then this innovation has been also filed. So this is the provisional one has been filed, and some of the work we have published in this Journal of Hazardous Material, where you can access to that. With this, I would just like to thank for this opportunity and WIN Foundation, who has not only funded but shared this platform to share our results, and which is fulfilling IIT Gandhinagar, and of course the coordinators of this webinar. Thank you very much. I will take questions if later.
Yes. Thank you, Professor Manish Kumar, for presenting some of the advanced research in a very quick time. I mean, we are mindful of time of the attendees more, but thank you so much. And we'll quickly move on to the questions. And well, one question very quickly is, can the desalinization system be modularized to treat 1,000 liters per hour system that can be installed in villages which are closer to the sea? And I would just add one question to that, whether they can be mounted right inside the sea, and whether that mounting inside the sea can reduce further, like a floating plant, and can reduce some transport costs. Yes, Professor Jaichandar, I guess.
Thank you for the question. So from the question, I understand that because we want to be closer to the sea, we are thinking about seawater desalination only. Just in terms of large scale seawater desalination, the scale that is usually talked about is in the hundreds of millions of liters per day. So this is much smaller than what are the established and successful examples of seawater desalination in India. There are a couple of challenges, I think, related to this. One is when you go to the smaller sizes, the economies of scale do not work in your favor anymore. So the cost number that we were presenting of around 50 rupees per kiloliter, that type of cost number may not be achievable. However, in the scientific literature, I have seen papers that talk about using different types of energy recovery devices to go down even to smaller levels, like around 500 liters per hour levels. But I have to check whether it has been implemented in practice or whether this was just an analysis. But it's really an interesting point to consider. To answer Pareshji's question on the mounting inside the sea, I think particularly in the context of wave power desalination, this particular idea has been explored in more detail, because there you are using the wave height going up and down, capturing that energy, and it makes sense to be you know, nearby to the sea or very close to the sea in that case.
Okay. There are two questions from Mr. M. Karthik, and I'll just cite both of them together. Why these technologies are not catching up in India despite water scarcity in many parts? I mean, what are the major obstacles other than the cost? And one more question which he has posed is also, any R&D in post use of the RO membranes? And I guess after disposal of RO membranes, what happens? That's his question.
So I will address the second question first, because there is a direct answer to that question. So after RO membranes are used for seawater desalination, oftentimes they are repurposed and used in industrial wastewater treatment applications, where you don't really require, you know, like instead of a new membrane, you use these used seawater membranes. The main idea there is that the membrane performance is not critical. In an industrial situation, the product water is being used back in the industry rather than being used for drinking and other purposes. In terms of the other question on why things are not catching up, well, that's a tricky question, because things are catching up in some sense. So there are many organizations that are setting up these water ATMs at a village level, taking groundwater, desalinating it with RO and or other technologies, and then providing it cost competitively. So this is actually as a social enterprise also, people are able to sustainably do this. People are able to make money running these water ATMs. So in that sense, it is quite you know, picking up even at the village level. But there are challenges also when we do it inland. One of the challenges that I not mentioned is, what do you do with the concentrate or the brine stream? If you put it back into the ground, you're actually going to make things worse for the future. So that is one important challenge I would touch upon. And if there's more time, I can come back to this question, I think.
Yes, there is another question from Hiram, IIT Gandhinagar. Mike is to Dr. Chinmay Goroy. How much quantity of water can be filtered from bacteria? I guess they mean how much of liters of water can be removed from per a single prototype of your product attached to the tap, if it is attached to the tap.
So I think that is the ongoing project with Win Foundation. So, but in the lab scale, we have using the 10 gram materials, we maximum have done 2 liters only. We are scaling it up. It will take some time. Some design problem we are facing, because these particles are very small. The 150 micron is very small particle. So design problem is that then you expect a little bit more pressure. So because of that, we found that there is some modification required in the prototype figure or picture I have shown you. So we are working on it, but we are hopeful that at least we'll be able to do whatever amount of water, whatever is required for a five member family.
There was just a comment by Mr. Saurav Ganguly. I don't know if the professor or Saurav Ganguly from ISC Bangalore, so not the other one. Very, and he has appreciated the relevant talks, and he has appreciated that the mechanism which Mr. Chinmay Goro is working on, that it can be used in many remote parts.
Thank
and
you.
There is a suggestion with Mr. Manish Kumar's work, if it can be. You can discuss with Professor Dr. Meera and Dinesh Mehta, except because they are doing a lot of this urban water and sanitation systems related work. I don't have any more questions on the list as far as I can see. Anybody else wants to pose, any of the panel members themselves want to pose a question? Of course, one question which another comes to my mind regarding desalination is, you know, which are the countries which have used really and producing very large percentage of needs from desalination? And maybe associated question is, are there any natural methods of desalination? I mean, as close to natural as possible. Yeah, of course, apart from the rain and which falls on us. Yeah.
There is a question. This is Ron Mehta. I have a question for Professor Jaichander. In the United States, in Santa Barbara, there was a major desalination project built, I believe, about 5 or 7 or 8 years ago for supplying of potable water when there was an acute shortage in California during one of the drought seasons. Has in an advanced country like US, have these approaches economically been found to be feasible? Because we have similar situations occurring now in India. Chennai went through this problem 2-3 years ago. Maybe you can comment on that.
Thank you. So about California, there is a large scale desalination plant. I think it's in a place called Carlsbad in California, where it has been economically viable as a solution, just because California depends to a large extent on, I think, the Colorado River water, which has to be pumped through enormous distances, like around 500 kilometers to reach some parts of California. So bringing in water from so far away is also expensive, as I showed in my presentation. And so this plant is functional and in right now. Of course, there were challenges because in terms of meeting the environmental regulations. So the cost, what I've heard is that had to be slightly on the higher side to meet some of those regulations. In the Indian context, again, you mentioned Chennai, which is very appropriate because Chennai is the one place in India where potable water production with desalination is being done on a large scale. So around 200 million liters per day of water, which these numbers might be a few years old, are around 12 to 13% of the municipal water requirement of the city is being met by desalination technologies already in Chennai. So this is two large plants of 100 MLD. And I also remember seeing in the news that additionally a couple of more plants of 100 MLD capacity were being planned in Chennai. And similarly in Gujarat, I think similar scales, like around 100 million liters per day plants are at some level of processing. So Paresh had asked one question about natural methods for desalination. So that has been a topic of interest to a lot of scientists. One thing to note is that a method will never be completely natural because of the minimum energy requirement from thermodynamics that I spoke about. But getting inspired by nature to come up with materials for desalination has actually borne some fruit. So there is a company called Aquaporin, where they use molecules from biology that are very adept at transporting water and kind of embedding these molecules into the RO membranes to increase the permeability of the RO membranes. And this has shown some promise and shown some good results. And other than that, I think Paresh mentioned one more question. Can you remind me what that was?
I think that was similar to, which are the, but I think partly answered. What are the large countries?
I can actually mention Israel gets most of its water from desalination. Singapore gets a lot of its water from desalination. So these are all examples of small countries that are otherwise dependent. For example, in the case of Singapore, they are otherwise dependent on Malaysia and they want to get rid of that dependency. So they ended up investing significantly in desalination technologies. And of course, most of the countries in the Middle East. So that's where desalination really was born, right? Because there you are just having acute water shortage for the most part, and you have to depend on seawater desalination there.
one attached question could be that, can you simply keep recycling water and would that be competitive with desalination, and whether that is
that is a very good point. And I briefly mentioned it in the talk today that there is a lot of push towards something called portable reuse, which involves desalination technologies, where we take the wastewater, but not just do the normal sewage treatment steps, but also have an RO and a UV or advanced oxidation process at the end to make sure that the grade of the water is extremely good. Usually portable reuse, direct portable reuse, which is mixing it back into the supply stream, I think is in place almost in Singapore. There are water bottles that are being marketed, which are portable reuse water bottles. But more often than not, this level of treatment is followed by putting this water back into the aquifer so that we get one more level of natural treatment, and then we pull it back up from the from the aquifer at some other location. So essentially it's being reused, but not like directly into a pipe, rather it's going into nature and coming back out of nature at some other point. This type of portable reuse is sometimes called indirect portable reuse. And this again is much more commonly in practice right now.
Okay, because that's also a subject of project of Professor Gangrekar at IIT Kharagpur, and who presented in the first webinar. So it will be interesting to watch the which one is cost effective at which place. And then, okay. So I think if there are, yeah. Okay.
One question for Jay. Jay means for MSMEs, mainly the dye production units. I think many cases, the TDS is very high. So so now they have the two options. They can use the RO and also multi-effect evaporator. So which one they should go? These are very small scale industries, you know. They don't have that much capital to invest. Of course, the multi-effect evaporator will be costlier, but is that we can do some modifications in our RO. Problem is that it may choke because the content is a little bit higher. So one thing is that whether we can improve that choking problem of these ROs. And other question is that whether we can use the RO in case there is no choking problem, then of course probably we can use that instead of ME, which is much more costlier problem.
So thank you, Professor Chinmay. You mentioned that the TDS is extremely high, right? So usually with conventional reverse osmosis technology, there exists a limitation in terms of TDS, not directly from the technology itself, but because of the pressure requirement. So if the TDS becomes higher than around 70,000 ppm, then no longer you can use RO because the applied pressure requirement becomes more than 70 bar, and the pressure vessels that are required for that are not usually available in the market. There are special examples of pressure vessels that go up to much higher pressures, like 200 bar also, but that is often a limitation. In terms of choking and membrane fouling, those are all real challenges for these industries when the TDS is lower than that limit. And that is the reason why if you look at textile or a dyeing industry, the RO membrane life might be only 1 or 2 years, whereas in a seawater plant, it might be 5 to 7 years, right? So that difference is primarily coming from the quality of that water. So some kind of pre-treatment. So I know that you are working on some pre-treatment that makes a very big impact on the cost of the life of these membranes.
So I'll take one very last question, which has come from attendees, that after desalination, what do you do with the salt? I think that is a very critical question in many other ways because we have reject water problem and whether we can recover salt from it or something. Yeah. Professor Jai Chandra.
Yeah. So after desalination, what do we do with the salt? That's a good question. There are some places where desalination is actually performed to produce salt as a product itself. So in Japan, for example, I think does not have as many salt mines. So usually in India, we are getting a lot of our salt right now from salt mines rather than from the ocean water getting dried up and then getting that salt. So sometimes that salt is specifically referred to as sea salt, as to contrast it from other salt. So in the case of Japan, if they don't have other sources of salt, desalinated brine is further concentrated, and then that solution is crystallized to produce salt. Okay. That needs to be economically viable. There should not be other sources of salt if that is something that we want to do. The other option is if you take the desalinated brine and again concentrate it up to a very high salinity and then separate out the other ions so that you only have sodium and chloride in your concentrated solution, then this can be used as input to produce sodium hydroxide and hydrochloric acid, which are very useful products or that can be sold in the market. And the third point I would like to make is that there are companies that are now looking at the brine as a valuable stream, not just for industrial brines, but even for seawater brine, because more and more the industry is looking for magnesium. In the industry, we want lithium, we want uranium for our power production. All of these elements exist in the sea, but at lower and lower quantities. So if we can figure out a method to, you know, effectively extract these valuable products, then the long-term perspective of the desalination industry is that they no longer want to be a water production industry. They don't want to use water as their revenue stream. They actually want to use these other products that are not water as their main revenue stream, because water itself could even be given for free. That's the long-term perspective in desalination.
Thank you very much. I think with this we will come to the end, and I will let I will call upon Falguni to propose vote of thanks.
Thank you, Parishi. On behalf of Kiransi Patel Center for Sustainable Development, firstly I would like to thank Professor Manish Kumar and Professor Chinmay Goroy for kindly agreeing to present their research and sharing their experience with the audience. I'd also like to thank Professor Jaichander for some very enlightening facts on desalination. Very special thanks to all the participants who had posed interesting questions and made this seminar more interactive. And we really appreciate your active participation in this webinar. I would also like to thank team members of the communication team, the technical teams, and all other members who have made this webinar a successful without any kind of problems. And they have also helped us in promoting this event so that many interested candidates can attend this webinar. So with this, I would like to thank each and every member who attended this webinar, and I again please give back to Professor Vora.
I just want to make an announcement for the next session. It is on 8th of October. I think Rahul can bring up the slide for the next session. Basically, on the 8th October, we have a session which is done by Win Foundation on startups. So it may be an interest. We have got a set of interesting innovators and startups to show how we can take innovative products to the communities and what are the challenges in taking them and all that. So hope to see you there on 8th October at 5:30 p.m. And thank you for attending.
Parishi, just a minute. So I would especially like to thank Win Foundation, all the organizers, because of which we collaborated and made this event a success together, all the co-organizers and the Win Foundation.
Thank you. Yes. Thank you so much, and thank you everyone who has waited patiently for this session. It was an interesting session, and we see you again, everybody, on 8th October at 5:30 p.m. Thank you, and have a good day.
Thank you.